Strixhaven introduces a lot of combo enablers, and in this video I collected 25 of them that go infinite or at least win the game right away. I'm going to start off with 22 combos from Strixhaven in alphabetical order, followed by 3 from Mystical Archives. Most of them are, you know, meant more for casual play, but all of them are a lot of fun. Starting with A, Accomplished Alchemist taps for an amount of mana equal to the amount of life we've gained this turn. So if we start with 4 white in our pool and activate Kenrith's white ability, then we gain 5 life and we'll have 1 white mana remaining. We then tap Accomplished Alchemist for blue to go up to 1 white and 5 blue in our mana pool. Next, we untap the Alchemist with High Alert, leaving 2 blue in our pool. And finally, we tap Accomplished Alchemist for white this time, and untap it, leaving 2 white and 1 blue in our pool. As you see, every loop we gain 1 mana, so we can continue this process to generate infinite mana, and eventually, infinite Kenrith activations. The end result? Infinite life, infinite +1/+1 counters, infinite card draw, and an alchemist who is feeling very accomplished.
Box breaks are the exciting way to get your hands on cards from the games you love while sharing the excitement with your friends and other collectors. With a huge variety of breaks to choose from across Magic, Pokemon, and Flesh and Blood, learn more today at cfbboxbreaks.com or check out CFB Box Breaks on YouTube.
The next combo is built around Belidraw's Witherbloom. I just love the text. Pay 10 life, untap all lands you control, and activate only once each turn. But did they really think this was going to stop us? Oh no. Alright, it does require a lot of setup. First, we need to transform Orgarel's Bloodfast into Temple of Eklatod. Also, we need to transform Journey to Eternity into Edzel Cave of Eternity, and have enough lands to activate it. But then we can start. Suppose we're currently at 1 life. We sacrifice Belidraw's Witherbloom to the temple, and along with Blood Artist and Bastion of Remembrance, will bring us back up to 7 life. Next, we return the dragon with the Cave of Eternity, and then, well, Belidraw's Witherbloom enters the battlefield, triggering Verdant Sun's Avatar, which altogether brings us back up to 11 life. Perfect! So this means that we can activate Belidraw's Witherbloom to untap all of our lands, and, you know, since each time it is entering as a new object without memory of its previous activations, we can just loop this as often as we want. Each time we drain our opponent with Blood Artist and Bastion of Remembrance, so the end result for our opponent is infinite life loss. Body of Research will usually be 40-40 or bigger, making it just the biggest vanilla creature ever, I mean excluding stuff like Big Fairy Monster or Infinity Elemental. Unfortunately though, it's easily stopped by Doomblade or Chump Blocks. However, when you combine it with Simic Ascendancy, which is a perfect match in terms of colors, then you'll win the game on your next upkeep for sure, no matter how many removal spells or jump blockers your opponent has. It's a simple, yet effective combo. Clarol Loom Monster is a spicy one. Just suppose you're playing a game of Modern and your opponent plays this creature on turn 1. You play a tap land and pass. You know, what's the worst that could happen? Well, how about lethal? Mutagenic Growth, Teemer Battle Rage. That yields 3 Magecraft triggers, and therefore a 10-10 double strike. Eh, not too bad on turn 2. So with that turn 2 kill potential, Clever Lumen Monster may actually fit right into Prowess decks in Modern. Crackle with Power should have really been a Quandrix card, but you know, let's do some math. On turn 2, we foretell Dual Strike and bide our time. Then, on turn 5, we go off. We cast Dual Strike for its foretell cost, and follow up with Ironcrack Feet. This produces 14 mana in total, which is exactly enough to cast Crackle with Power for X is 4. That means 20 damage to each of up to 4 targets, including our opponent. As a turn 5 sorcery based combo involving 3 cards, this is not super competitive, but still a fun combo for jank brewing in Standard. Dina, Soulsteeper, says that whenever you gain life, each opponent loses 1 life. So if you also control Exquisite Blood, then the first time you gain life or your opponent loses life, you'll set off an infinite loop that results in infinite drains. There were already several cards that combo with Exquisite Blood in this way, but Dina is the first historic legal 2-drop that does so, so maybe it inches an Exquisite Blood deck slightly closer to competitive viability. Double Major produces a copy of a creature spell on the stack, and that has some potential. On turn 7, we first cast Seagate Stormcaller, then Dual Caster Mage, and hold priority. With Dual Caster Mage on the stack, we target it with Double Major. Thanks to Seagate Stormcaller, Double Major is copied, which produces a copy of the Dual Caster Mage. Let's just call him, I don't know, Luis. So now at this point, the original Dual Caster Mage is still on the stack, as well as the original Double Major, and they're going to remain there forever. Luis's Enter ETB effect copies the Double Major, which then produces another Luis, which makes another Double Major copy, and so on. The end result is an infinite loop that creates an infinite number of Dual Caster Mage copies. Now, if no one has a way to stop the loop, then the game will actually be a draw. However, you can break out of the loop by, say, casting and copying an opt rather than Double Major, and then passing the turn with an arbitrarily large number of 2/2s. Maybe this is all too convoluted and too mana intensive, but still something to consider for Neoform decks, maybe as like a 5th or 6th Neoform if they're interested in that. Strixhaven has several rituals and mana producers which are just asking for combos. Suppose you cast Explosive Welcome, which creates a treasure thanks to Stormkill Artist, and then you copy the instant with Nivix Guildmage. This does require you to have 11 mana at the start of the turn, probably not competitive, but it will go infinite. The copy will create a treasure, and then deal 5 damage to your opponent, 3 damage to one of their creatures, and add 3 red mana. That's enough to copy the original once more, and you can keep up the explosions as long as the viable targets remain. Welcome to Prismari. The next combo is based around Extus, Auric Overlord, specifically its Magecraft ability. It returns a creature card from your graveyard to your hand, and this synergizes nicely with modal double-faced cards that are creatures on the front side and instant or sorcery spells on the back side. If you have one such MDFC in your graveyard and another in your hand, then you can cast the one from your hand as an instant or sorcery, and then return the MDFC from your graveyard, because that's a creature, and loop this as often as mana allows. This can get really nutty when the two MDFCs are both Wandering Archaic, which is a colorless spell, and you have enough effects, via say Umori, Rowan, and Will, to make sorceries 3 less to cast. Then Explore the Vastlands is free, and you can cast it as often as you like. You cast one, return the other from your graveyard to your hand, and so on. Now that by itself doesn't really accomplish much, because Explore the Vastlands is a symmetric effect, but if you control Quakebringer, then your opponent won't gain any life, and in the meantime, you will gain infinite life. At that point, you'll also have drawn all the instant and sorcery cards from your deck, so that should be enough to cobble together a win. For a common, First Day of Class has a lot of constructed applications. It can even set up an infinite combo in Pauper. For example, if you control Goblin Slayer and sacrifice Putrid Goblin, then it'll return with a -1/-1 counter due to Persist, and a +1/+1 counter due to First Day of Class. These counters cancel out, so you can keep sacrificing as much as you want. The end result is infinite +1/+1 pumps. Not bad for a common only combo that you can pull off as early as turn 3. With Galazeth Prismari, a wacky loop is possible. You need a dragon, a treasure, and 2 marauding raptors on the battlefield. Thanks to the dinosaur's cost reduction, then a treasure is enough to cast Mirror Image. As it enters the battlefield, you copy Galazeth Prismari, which creates a treasure. The mirror image immediately dies to the raptors, which in turn triggers Death's Oasis. Now here's where it gets a bit tricky. Mirror image had converted mana cost 4 when it was on the battlefield, because it was a copy of Galazeth Prismari, but as a creature card in the graveyard, its converted mana cost, or mana value nowadays, is 3. Therefore, Death's Oasis allows mirror image to return itself, and you can loop this as often as you want. With every loop, Death's Oasis mills you for 2, so assuming you have Tassa's Oracle anywhere in your deck, you can eventually return it and cast it for the win, or alternatively, you can exploit a card like Blood Artist for infinite drains. Grinning Ignis is an awesome reprint for combo purposes. If you control Birgi, then you can cast, return, and loop Grinning Ignis as often as you want. This yields infinite Enters the Battlefield triggers and an infinite Storm count. In Historic, you can then easily kill with Grapeshot. In Standard, you have access to Terror of the Peaks. In either case, it's a 3-card combo to produce infinite damage. In a self-mill deck, Harness Infinity can set up a kill once you've put 20 creature cards from your library into your graveyard. All you need is to control Sire Conrad the Grim, and then you'll turn the contents of your graveyard into 20 damage pinks. Easy, yet deadly. Hopefully Ghost Forge in a format like Commander is just asking for infinite loops. One possibility is with Miss Moon Griffin. Sacrifice the Griffin to Golem Bombardment, and then Hofri exiles the Griffin to create a token. For now, just forget about Miss Moon Griffin's death trigger, but do note that it doesn't target. Next, we sacrifice the token to Goblin Bombardment, which puts two triggers on the stack. First to resolve is the one stemming from Hofri Ghost Forge, which puts the original Miss Moon Griffin into the graveyard. Afterwards, the ability that says exile Miss Moon Griffin, then return a top creature card of your graveyard to the battlefield, you know, the one from the token, resolves as much as possible. So that returns the original Miss Moon Griffin to the battlefield, and then we can just loop this for infinite damage. Journey to the Oracle has a line of text that is easily breakable. I mean, any number of lands, untapped, oh, let's go. It just requires 15 lands, a full hand, and 7 easy steps. But alright, step 1. Tap all of your untapped lands for mana. Step 2. Return most of your lands to your hand, but we do leave 3 islands onto the battlefield. Step 3, we put most or all of our lands onto the battlefield with Journey to the Oracle, as long as we have exactly 7 cards in hand afterwards. We'll discard an arbitrary instant or sorcery to return Journey to the Oracle to our hand. Then, Sunch Court's Desert, that's step 4, pings our opponent for 1 damage. Then, step 5, we get the 2 copies of Mystic Sanctuary, that's why we kept the islands. They put Leaf Chance and the arbitrary instant or sorcery card back on top of our library. Step 6, well, how about introducing the Biblioplex? So we activate the Biblioplex, hold priority, and activate a second one in response. We'll draw Leaf Chance and the arbitrary instant or sorcery card that we discarded to Journey to the Oracle. And then step 7 is just looping this, keep doing this, until we have pinged our opponent to death. The next combo is a bit simpler. With Killian Ink Duelist on the battlefield, Illusionist Stratagem only costs 2 mana. We can exploit that by targeting Returned Past Caller and Goldspan Dragon. Then Returned Past Caller brings back Illusionist Stratagem to our hand, and Goldspan Dragon's Treasure can then pay for the instant. This means that we can keep blinking these two creatures as often as we like. Since we draw a card every time, we'll be able to draw our deck with ease and then win somehow. In Modern, I'm not sure if combo decks with Spike Feeder and Devoted Druid need another enabler, especially a 4-mana one that only works if you control both creatures. But hey, Strixhaven does offer one. Lisette, Dean of the Root. If you remove a +1/+1 counter from Spike Feeder to gain 2 life, then you can tap Devoted Druid to pay for Lisette, the triggered ability, and then this puts a +1/+1 counter on each creature you control. This means that we can untap Devoted Druid, activate Spike Feeder once more, and loop for infinite life. We already used Nivix Guildmage and Stormkiln Artist to go infinite with Explosive Welcome, but we can also get there with Prismari Command. It does require Goldspan Dragon to supercharge our treasures, but we only need 5 mana at the start of the turn to pull it off. The modes for Prismari Command are to deal 2 damage to our opponent and to create a treasure, well, for us, of course. Nivix Guildmage costs 4 mana to copy it, and thanks to Stormkiln Artist and the effect of the copy, we create 2 treasures every loop. Thanks to Goldspan Dragon, that's enough to keep the wheel spinning. The end result? Infinite damage. One Krondrix Command is nice, but infinite is even better. This is possible in Commander with Crystalline Crawler. The idea is that you cast Krondrix Command with the Return Target Creature to its owner's hand mode, and the put 2 +1/+1 counters on target creature mode. It doesn't even really matter what you target at first, because it's going to be a while before the original will actually resolve. With Krondrix Command on the stack, we copy it with Jewel Caster Mage. The copy bounces Jewel Caster Mage and puts the +1/+1 counters onto Crystalline Crawler. Thanks to hardened skills, this turns into 3 mana, exactly enough to recast Jewel Caster Mage. The end result is an infinite storm count, so we can top off with Grapeshot for the win. The next combo sets up a silly infinite loop with Quintorius Field Historian. Now don't try this nonsense at home, but suppose you cast Squee the Immortal from the graveyard. Then Quintorius creates a spirit, which can be sacrificed to Kaikar Wind's Fury for 1 red mana. And then we sacrifice Squee to Skirk Prospector for another red mana. If we then also control Gravebreaker Lamia, then recasting Squee only costs 2 mana, so we can keep this up as often as we like, yielding infinite Enters the Battlefield triggers. Terror of the Peaks will then happily turn that into infinite damage. If you start the turn with Ruta, Mercurial Artist on the battlefield and 8 mana available, then you can cast Desperate Ritual, splice through the breach, and copy the combined spell with Ruta. The copy then puts Ruta onto the battlefield and adds 3 red mana. 2 of that can be used to create yet another copy of the instant, and loop to produce infinite mana. Afterwards, a simple fireball will lead to victory. The final combo with Strixhaven proper is based around Witherbloom Apprentice, and it's as simple as it is deadly. Cast Chain of Smog targeting yourself, and keep copying it. Each time, Witherbloom Apprentice drains your opponent for 1. So that's 2 cards, 4 mana, and infinite drains. Maybe that's still not powerful enough for Legacy, but at least it's a nice new option. The final 3 combos will be based on cards from Mystical Archive. First up, Ephemerate and Time Warp. If you also control Shipwreck Dowser, then on your main phase you can cast Time Warp, then Ephemerate on Shipwreck Dowser to return Time Warp, and then you get an extra turn. In your upkeep of that extra turn, Rebound kicks in, so you blink Shipwreck Dowser, return Ephemerate, and are ready to do it all over again. All the turns in the game are now yours. To make the most of Tainted Pact, you should play a deck with all singletons. Then, once you have 5 mana, you cast Tainted Pact and copy it with Lutrie. With the first copy, you dig until you find Tassa's Oracle, and with the second copy, you dig until the second card from the bottom of your library. Then, you untap, draw your last card, and cast Tassa's Oracle for the win. Shout out to Sam Black for the idea. You have to play a singleton deck to make this work even in your mana base, and that is a steep price, but this does unlock Lutrie as your companion, and as a result you basically only have to draw Tainted Pact, making this a one card combo that is potentially very powerful. Channel Fireball is one of the most iconic combos in the history of the game, so much so that an entire website, which of course has you covered for all of your Strixhaven needs, is named after it. Now, in Mystical Archive, Channel is reprinted, and there's also an X-spell in Strixhaven, so you can see where this is going. In the new limited format, it is now possible on turn 4 to cast Channel, pay 12 life, and cast Crackle with Power for 20 damage. It's bound to happen at some point, and I can't wait to see Channel Fireball in Strixhaven Limited. Well, and with that, I come to the conclusion of this list of 25 combos. I hope you enjoyed it, maybe it gave you some inspiration, and thank you for watching.